Welcome, everyone, to tonight's installment of the SCI-Arc Cinema Series. This is now in its third year, and we're doing it the first Tuesday of every month during the school year. And there's plans afoot to start doing it more than that. Fingers crossed we can start doing it in the summers as well. The Cinema Series is part of the school's initiative to bring liberal arts to the architectural education, also for a way for us to give back to our neighborhood here in the Arts District. And I'm always happy to see people outside of my student base out in the audience. So my name is Michael Stock. I'm the programmer and host of the series. This is my fifth year teaching here. And this semester, teaching two courses, and a bunch of my students are here. One is the required course for third year students called Film and Architecture. And the other class is an elective on the history of horror films. And so tonight's film, Pleasantville, plugs in to both of those, I think, in a way. I want to thank you folks who were here last month for our screening of Donnie Darko, and glad that you came back. I feel like tonight's screening is a good follow-up to Donnie Darko, which was made 2 years later and provides another really interesting 90s point of view on the very flawed fantasy of suburban America. I think it'll be really interesting for all of you watching the film tonight from a 2020 perspective, seeing a 90s perspective on how the dream was already falling apart and how the darkness was sort of already creeping in during the Bush years. And literally, in this film, you see it creeping in color. And certainly a timely visit, film to revisit as on today. I don't know, wearing my I voted sticker here. And I definitely want to talk to our guest here about the kind of political side of the film, which is sort of bubbling along under the laughs and this sort of warm picture of this version of America. So Pleasantville, released in 1998, directed by Gary Ross. And my guest tonight is the film's production designer, Jeannine Oppewall. And you received an Oscar nomination for the film. And so I want to welcome Jeannine tonight. So I'm gonna read to you here a little bit from her bio, kind of fill you in a little bit more on her, and then she's gonna present to us some of the behind the scenes stuff from the getting ready to shoot Pleasantville. So Jeannine started her career working with Charles and Ray Eames, among the most famous American designers and filmmakers in recent history. The first film that Jeannine designed was Tender Mercies in 1983. She has received Academy Award nominations for LA Confidential, Pleasantville, Seabiscuit, and The Good Shepherd. Other films for which she is known are Catch Me If You Can, The Bridges of Madison County, The Music Box, and let's see, make sure I'm getting all the names mentioned here. And let's see, she served on the Board of Governors at the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences for 9 years. Last year, she received a Lifetime Achievement Award from the Art Directors Guild for her 40 years of outstanding work. And I think the last time I saw you was right around that time.
And I told them it was premature.
Yeah, a little early for the Lifetime Award. So since her film career began in 1981, Jeannine has given texture and realism to nearly 50 films, moving from set director to art director to production designer. She oversees the finding of locations and the design and construction of sets and interiors, from curtains and carpets to chairs and lamps. A production designer, she said, is responsible for everything an actor walks in front of, sits on, drives through, or picks up. And so you brought some slides tonight.
I did.
And I'm going to
something about
you go.
I have some pictures of the process by which my department, known as the art department, built the sets. And of course, what you need to remember was that this film was made in the Jurassic Park era, so that all of the drawings are still being done by hand, and no one was as versed as everyone is now with doing all the technical drawings on the computer. So you'll see some very antique-looking drawings here. Okay, so I thought I should say a little bit first about what the film may or may not be about, for those of you who haven't seen it. Often you get these people in the studios writing taglines for films, and you, having worked on the film, you look at it and you think, where did they come up with that? But this one's actually pretty good. Nothing is as simple as black and white. And the film is set in the 1950s. It really is about the nature and meaning of the United States in a very friendly, calm, comical way. It pokes fun at us on political and artistic levels, and it talks about the blacks versus the whites and the coloreds versus the black and whites, and with all the emotional and political implications that you can read out of that comment. It also talks a great deal about artistic freedom and repression and conformity and the need to break out of the conformity and what does it take to need to break out of conformity. And as you go along, you will notice there are two really important sets of buildings in the film. One is the soda shop, which we thought of as the seat of sedition, where all of the revolutions were fomented. And the other is the kind of the town hall, which was a kind of a nationalist, socialist, hard-ass kind of plain 1930s-like building. You frequently see these kinds of buildings in small towns in America everywhere. Okay, so that's all I'm going to say right now about what the film could be about. And this is the location day one. We built the entire town for this movie. We looked several places and finally ended up choosing the parking lot and the Malibu Creek State Park. Malibu Creek State Park had a history of the film business. It was 20th Century Fox's old Western lot, which they sold and or gave it to State of California as a park. And we were allowed, because of that history, we were allowed to film there. But we had to be very careful how we oriented the streets, because there were some Indian middens known to be hidden down at one end. So it was a matter of getting with the park rangers, learning where this stuff was, and canting the set a little bit. So some of the odd things you have to deal with when you're trying to design sets. So for the first few weeks, since the town, we had to build an entire town of idealized, generic, quintessential, all-American streets in the town, I just spent day after day after day galloping through typical kinds of drawings for typical kinds of buildings in small-town America. Here's the grocery store and the fire station, for example. The furniture store, the bowling alley. And this was the drawing of the whole town. What you see is, on the left, is how you would get in and get out of it. And the basic structure, which is, at one end is the seat of power, the town hall, and at the other end on the right, you'll see the little soda shop. This will all become clear a little bit later. But you can see that these drawings have been living in my garage for quite some time. I don't think they'll ever iron out. Okay, now if you think we have a lot of money to build models, you need to think again. You have about a day and a half to make a white paper model with some mossy trees, and this is what we did. So there you see the town hall at the end, and right up here at this end is where we had the soda shop. So it's essentially one street and a cross street. That's all the town consists of. And we had to figure out what colors to make the buildings in brick so that each one in color would be distinguishable from its neighbor, but in black and white would also be distinguishable from the neighbor. So basically, you have a red brick, a brown brick, and a yellow brick. And we made all kinds of combinations of those things, and we studied how to do them, how they would look next to each other in various versions of black and white and color. I'm one of those people that I can't really understand how to do it by reading about it. I have to physically get out there and do it. So how I learned about this at the time was I ran around with two cameras, one stuffed with color film and one stuffed with black and white film, and I shot the same damn thing again and again and again with both black and white and color so I could put the pictures next to each other and understand what in the world it was going to look like and what both ways, because it had to look perfectly acceptable in black and white and in color. It's a bit tricky. And then we had to have awnings, so you know, we went through the awning book, and the awnings had to be distinguishable, again, one from the other. And there's my little watercolor of the soda shop. This is kind of a classic hamburger fries soda place where the kids hang out and cause the rebellion. And this is into the process of construction, laying out the sidewalks and then starting to build the facades. More building. It took several months for this to happen. All in the parking lot. There's the town hall at the end. This was a Sunday when we were laying asphalt on our street. And these are the buildings partially to fully dressed. Pretty much almost done, the town here. And on the left side, you see the tree trunks. You can buy tree trunks much cheaper. You can buy a giant tree and drop it in. So we bought the tree trunks, and every leaf of a certain species in the country of Taiwan, we attached, the greens people attached them to the trees. So there they are with their equipment attaching the leaves to these barren tree trunks. And here we are laying out the carpet grass. So it looks as though it's been there for a while. See, and again, I shot everything in color and in black and white because I wanted to make sure that I wasn't making any really stupid errors, that it would look just as good in black and white as it did in color. And this is, I was hiking in the hills on one Sunday and looked down on my little town. There it is on the right. Here it is with a telephoto lens. And that's the Malibu Hindu temple. And there's a scene involving a rainbow in the film. And this was a sketch for, you know, how the rainbow might work over the town. And these are a few details of during the production. The barbershop haircutter's chair is really built, designed it and built like a throne. It was where the guy who, the mayor of the town, sat to get his hair cut. And on the right, this is inside the Santa Monica Women's Club, which we turned into a kind of a quasi interior town hall for conducting a court scene. And that's the enforced friendliness of the 50s symbol. And there's several scenes involving window painting. There's a repressed artist who runs the soda shop, and he starts out by painting very ordinary Christmas windows every year. And then he gets a little crazy. He's been reading too many art books, and he does a cubist Santa Claus. And then he gets even crazier, and he makes a painting of his naked girlfriend. So there we are. We had three windows of the naked girlfriend. That's Marion Westall, our scenic artist, and she's touching up one of the glass windows, that something gets thrown through these windows on screen. And this is the mural, which you'll also see on screen. And this Frank Romero, who's a very well-known Chicano artist here in Los Angeles, painted this for us. I knew Frank from working at the Eames office. He was working as a graphic designer there for a while, and I always remembered him and liked him. And I thought his sensibility, from knowing the kinds of paintings that he made, I thought his sensibility would be perfect for the story. So I sent him a script, and he called me back, and he said, "This is everything I love." So I said, "Great, you know." And when you see, he really did a great job of this. You see the illegal kissing going on. You see the bowling ball mowing down some people. You see some naked ladies, some books being burned with their wings flying up to heaven. He really understood what the story was about. And this is the clip, okay. See the sign, no coloreds. Okay, more pictures of the town being dressed. There was a storyboard artist who was working with us on the details of some of the important scenes of sedition in the soda shop. And there's the soda shop. This we shot, we built the inside and the outside of this thing and the place right on the Malibu Creek State Park. And here we are shooting. And you can see the row of buildings on the left. It's just a series of facades. I'm on the roof here of the town hall.
And you can't stop something that's inside you.
It is not inside me.
Oh, sure it is.
No, it is not.
What do you want to do to me right now? Come on. Everyone is turning colors. Kids are making out in the street. No one is getting their dinner. Hell, you could have a flood any minute. Pretty soon, the women could be going off to work while the men stayed at home and cooked.
That is not going to happen.
But it could happen.
No, it could not.
Bud.
Look at this.
all good things must come to an end. I was the only person who decided I had to go out and watch the place be destroyed. I was talking with Michael a little bit earlier and saying, the only record of the architecture put together by a film designer is what exists on screen. And all this stuff had to go to the landfill because there was a moment when Malibu Creek State Park thought about keeping it, and then they realized there were not enough, they could not afford enough guards to make sure that nobody sat and smoked in the building and burned all of Calabasas down. So it's too big of a liability, basically. So I think that's it. Yes, that's it. All right. Turning this thing off.
Okay. So I want to ask you a few questions, and then we'll go into the film. So last time we talked, and in other interviews, you've mentioned that you choose projects based on something that forces you to explore something about yourself. And I was wondering what that thing was with Pleasantville.
I grew up in small town, middle America. I have a lot to say about that experience. All of the rigidity and all of the rules about how you must be good and how you must be as a girl. I couldn't wait to get out. So there's a lot of me in that town. If you look carefully, the library was pretty much copied after the town library that in the town I grew up in, and all the authors whose names run around the outside are my favorite authors from English literature. It's a way of exploring and rethinking who you are, how you were brought up to be, why you became someone else, and it's a concentric circles. You have to keep kind of licking around the edges of that, around and around and around. It's a way of knowing how you are, who you are, where you come from. So I spent a lot of time thinking about small town America while making this. Mm-hmm.
And how much of this was sort of secret? I mean, like, did you discuss this with the director, or was this part of your world within the world of the film?
The director and I talked a lot, but he really wasn't, aside from saying that he thought that the town hall had to be the seat of order and the soda shop needed to be the seat of sedition. Basically, we didn't discuss much else in terms of the way that the buildings were laid out, or we worked out how many buildings we could afford. And the interesting thing was that I realized after a while, I was a little slow, that the people who budgeted the film originally budgeted it by taking each of the buildings that was mentioned in the script, and they budgeted for that building. But of course, the problem is that people have to walk from one building to another, and they can't be walking past nothing. So you have to fill in with all this stuff that isn't really called for in the story. And it took a very long time for people to come to that understanding. And when I went to the first screening of the film, I think it was held in Seattle, test screening, I sat down and somebody I didn't recognize came and sat next to me, and then I hear the producer in the back yelling at me, Jeannine, come here. So I get up and I stumble over this poor guy next to me, and I go in the back and he says to me, do you know who's sitting next to you? I said, I have no idea. He said, well, that's the guy who paid for the film, that's the studio head. And don't say a damn thing about that town that you built. He still thinks you found it. Well, how can this be? I spent $5 million on a pre-existing town. I mean, he should have fired me. Anyway, so those are some of how it works.
Wow. And so is that a fairly typical range of freedom, like with the other films that you've worked with, in terms of what you're given this sort of sparse outline of the world, and then you fill in the rest?
I don't know if that's fairly typical or not, but it should be. I don't work very well with people who think that they know more than I do about what I do for a living. It just doesn't work. You know, my feeling is if you figure out who I am and you hire me, you should be prepared to put up with everything that comes along with that. And I just, it's just better for me personally if I am given few directions, but I go back frequently and say, this is what I want to do, this is why I want to do it. Here are two or three ground plans for how the interior of this set can work. Let's pick one together, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. I like the freedom to hang myself. Better that way.
Yeah.
Rather be hung by myself than by somebody else.
Right. Was this your first film working in black and white?
Yeah, I think so.
And have you done any since then?
I don't think any since,
yeah.
No.
I was wondering if, you know, I had read, I think last time when we talked about you working for Charles Eames, that one of your first jobs was cataloging black and white photographs, black and white films. So I was wondering if that was your sort of primal training in black and white, or if or how you prepared for a very different way of making a film.
Well, really, someone came to me after the film opened and said, oh, I guess you must have spent a lot of time watching all those old black and white TV shows from the 50s. And I went, it never occurred to me. Like I said, I mean, I have to physically and emotionally experience it myself, or I don't really know how to interpret it or how to do it. So everything that you do before you do the next thing is preparation for the next thing. Everything you've learned, every image you've accumulated, every time you've fallen down and picked yourself up, that's all services you for the next project that you do or the next phase of your life. It's all part of one big buildup. So I can't really say that I could point to anything specifically. It's, you just bring it all to the table and see what works.
Has there ever been a time where you have realized, oh, you're reappropriating something from something you've already done? You're remixing or revisiting yourself?
Well, actually, I did buy a table and chairs, dining room set, in some small town in Iowa in a junk store, and I used it on Bridges of Madison County. And then I thought about, it was a table we needed, and I think it was LA Confidential, and we could not find the right table. And I went back to the studio prop shop, and I said, there it is. We already have that in Bridges of Madison County. So, yeah, you're always stealing from yourself in a way, because you are who you are. There are certain images, certain objects that make sense to you, and you gravitate toward those. Because, you know, it's said, you are who you are, and that's what they get when they pay for you to be there.
Right. We talked a little bit before we came up here and sat down about color versus black and white and how it's coded in this film, but also, you know, I was thinking, you know, sort of as I was revisiting this film, like how our relationship to black and white has changed in 2020 as opposed to even 1998. So, you know, Instagram filter versus sort of pure referentiality in the 90s?
I think that we could be a lot more lighthearted in the 50s about the situation than we can be now. I mean, now I think everybody gets the black and the whites versus the coloreds. But I think it was less obvious then. Because the country was a totally different country then. And you could riff off of it on many levels. That's harder to do today.
And how radically different is your job when you're building a town from scratch as opposed to like LA Confidential, where you're having to rebuild a past in a present time?
Well, it takes a lot longer to build a whole town, that I can tell you. And you have to go, you have to be prepared to go really fast and to make decisions quickly and to live with them. So you have to be sure about yourself and what your feeling is about the things that you're building. You don't have the time or the luxury to think about it very much. You just have to do it.
And then, so how do you live with these things afterwards? Like when you're revisiting the film like you will tonight, stuff that
I crawl under the table sometimes, you know. And there's some, you know, nobody gets it all right. There are things that you come closer to getting right. But you really don't, you know, I see the flaws because, you know, and I see the memories and I see the history. And I see the blood on the street, but I don't think the whole idea is to make sure that no one else sees it. You know, because there's a, just try to hide the injuries.
The films that you are best known for are predominantly period pieces. Is this reflective of your own tastes, or is it because you've been pigeonholed as a period?
Well, you know, Hollywood is a big believer in pigeonholes. And if you're lucky, when you start out, you're able to do something that demonstrates that you know how to do that thing. Because producers want assurance that whoever they hire to spend their money, they want some belief that says, oh yes, well, they've done it once before, they can do it again, that kind of thing. So I happen to like working on period films because I'm a glutton for punishment, and they're about four times as difficult. And every year that goes by, they get increasingly difficult to make. So I don't know if that answers your question, but I got used to doing it. I started to learn all the shortcuts and what you could get away with and what you couldn't get away with, and how to hide things cheaply, fast, and simply. As I said, I think I'm a glutton for punishment. I like talking about history, talking about the past. I'm not somebody who would be very good on a futurist film. I have the devil of a time understanding the present. Understanding the past is really hard as far as the future's concerned. That's somebody else's job. It scares me too much. It's a personality thing.
Yeah. Are there any of your films that you feel you sort of played against type? I've seen you, in other interviews you've mentioned, sort of comparing your status as a production designer being typecast to actors.
Yes.
Any films you feel like you went against type, and did it work?
Oh, I can't think of any. Well, I can think of one horrible failure, which we're not going to talk about, where I took a job with a director who I really disliked intensely. And I spent most of the movie trying to get off the job. So the moral of the story is be very careful what you say yes to.
Yeah.
Because it can be painful. It's very, very difficult to get up in the morning anyway and work as hard as you have to work to do things like this. But to have to work with someone who you don't understand or have a real genuine feeling for, whose idiosyncrasies you simply do not get, that's living hell. So it's like having the wrong client. Oh God, why did I do that?
So to young production designers in the audience, maybe, who are thinking about this this career path, is there a way to avoid that situation, or is that part of the terrain?
It's really an instinctual thing. It's really coming to understand enough about who you are as a person and what you can put up with and what you're interested in and what you're unwilling to put up with. It's really a personality thing. There are people who came to me after they understood that I had worked with Gary Ross a few times, and they just, oh, how could you stand it? he's this, he's that, or something. I don't know. I just, if he says something stupid, I just laugh and walk off and ignore it. I don't take it seriously. Same thing with another director who would just like start ranting about something, and I would just laugh and I'd walk off. And his wife came to me and said, well, how do you deal with that when he's so grumpy? I just said, well, you know, he says something stupid and grumpy, I act like I haven't heard it. I have a job to do. So there are all kinds of different people have different ways of dealing with it. My way is to just sort of laugh and not listen. You know, if something's really dumb that just got said, don't say, that's a dumb thing. Just sort of smile and disappear and ignore that you ever heard that.
When you were here last time, and talking about LA Confidential, you had mentioned something, which I've thought a lot about since then, how part of your job is making the set a nest for actors.
Yes.
And, I mean, so if you can talk about that a little bit with our new audience here, like literally you're building in a sense of comfort for them?
Building in a sense of environment and place that puts them in a better frame emotionally, psychically, to do their job. Because the art department, my department, we are the first people out there, ahead of everybody else in the film crew. And it is our job to do a great job so that everybody else coming behind us, and that includes actors, is forced to come up to the mark. And that's part of what I mean by you're building an environment, you're building a nest for them, but you're also trying to make everyone in the film crew understand what they're dealing with and respect it and do a good job in it and bring people up to as high a place as you can bring them up. And that's because you're first. It's the job. Mm-hmm. If you leave the place a pigsty, you think anybody's going to care when they come in, you know, the set's a mess? No, it can't be that way. Your job is to make other people's jobs easier and better and clearer. I mean, the more you know about what everybody else does for a living on the film set, the better off you are because you can protect them and you can protect yourself. And a part of it is just imagining what it is that other people need in order to do their job. It's understanding that you can't put people in four walls in a square box and expect there to be much good that comes out of that. There needs to be depth. There has to be a place for the eye to travel and to try to learn more and to see more in the background and the distance. There has to be something attractive, something repellent. It's really all about understanding what the camera's gonna see in the process of telling the story. It's about the story. I mean, I've seen some people who get into the film business because they have technical talents, but you would never want to ask them about storytelling because that's not part of who they are. People in my position, in the production designer's position, second nature is to have a feeling for storytelling. It just has to be something you need. I mean, I've always felt that I had an addiction to fiction, and this is part of how it comes out in me. When lights out in school and when I was a kid, I was always under the covers with the flashlight finishing the novel. But that it's part of, you have to have that feeling for story and for character and how to work it out in terms of an environment. That's what it takes.
Was there anything you discovered while working on Pleasantville that changed your trajectory as a production designer? Any like breakthroughs or new rules that you discovered?
No, but I don't think I want to do anything quite that hard again. That was really difficult.
The most of all your films, the most difficult?
No, maybe The Good Shepherd was harder. That was on, you know, three countries and 186 sets. That was like about 100 too many.
Maybe just one more question. With the boom of streaming services and home viewing and the sort of preference of the small screen, again, sort of another loop within film history, how has your job as a production designer changed?
One of the problems, and everybody says the same thing, is that TV is still operating with the old rules about how fast you have to work and how fast you have to literally sling the sets out there. It's operating the way it was operating in the 50s, the 60s, the 70s. It's just operating on the same business model. But what they expect is feature quality delivering of the sets. So it basically is a formula for chewing people out and spitting them out. I mean, you can exhaust yourself utterly trying to do a big period television series. It's because the studio executives often have zero concept of what's involved physically with those kinds of requests. They just don't know how much work it takes and how much it costs to get today turned back in time. But they expect somehow, because you've done it before, they've all seen it before, they expect that it's just, that it's easy. And it's never easy, and it's always difficult to explain why it's not easy. So it's, you know, basically it's expecting more for less, basically. And I'm always amazed that people actually get it done. You know, I think it's like, you know, donkey is on the trail, and, you know, suddenly you've proven the donkey can live on, you know, three cups of water and, you know, five pieces of straw a day, and you think, let's take away one of those cups of water and one piece of straw and see if the donkey lives. Well, the donkey croaks, well, there's plenty of other donkeys coming up the trail. Let's commandeer one of those. It can be very difficult. I mean, I personally prefer the pacing of film rather than TV because I get more time to think about what I do. And TV, you don't have as much time to think. You just have to bloody do it and hope it's going to be okay. And I did a big period TV series called Good Girls Revolt, and I was utterly shocked, coming from film, at the wasted efforts that the art department was expected to just produce. We would produce a set, oh, well, we didn't shoot that, we wrote it out of the script, okay, take that set, turn it into another set for next week, okay, and then the next week you get another script and they want what you just destroyed back. I thought, if I ever did anything as dumb as that on a feature, I'd be fired for wasting people's time and money. But they don't think anything of that in TV because it just has a different rhythm and a different set of requirements. And some people love it, and they're very well suited for it. But I like to spend a little more time thinking about the color and the metaphor and sinking into it a little bit more. But that's me. I'm just not. You have to know who you are.
Cool. Last question. Anything in the film that's maybe buried, submerged, out of focus? Anything special from that world that you built that we should look for, that the film doesn't give enough attention to?
Well, you know that we built the whole town. That'll be obvious while you're watching the town. When it comes to what's called Lover's Lane, and you see all these trees and flower and the park with the lovely plants leading down to this pond. That was all built too. The grass, planted the grass, planted the trees, planted the, you know, the, taped the flowers on the trees. So it's almost nothing in this film that was not built, except for the interior of the bowling alley, and a great deal of that was modified. So it's sort of an unusual project in that way. I mean, because it's an artificial world that's mimicking a world that we remember to talk about who we are when the film came out. So it's many-layered, mm-hmm. but there's nothing real about it. It's meant to convey a quintessential idea of a place. That's all.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Cool. Thank you very much. Thanks.